Hey guys, I'm excited. The long-awaited Raspberry Pi 5 is here. Or to be precise, right from the beginning, it's coming in less than a month, in October 2023. To be honest with you, I didn't believe it. I had like zero hope that it would manage to come out this year. But I'm glad I was wrong. I hope Raspberry will be able to salvage some of its reputation after the long shortage that damaged its name. And in that spirit, enough of that. Let's check out what's coming at us. I'm by no means a big shot YouTuber, so I don't have the physical device just yet. I've pre-ordered it the same way you can, and I need to wait till mid-October to get my hands on it. But that won't stop us, right? So, what's it going to be like? It's going to be the same form size as its predecessor, so a credit card sized single board computer with mounting holes in the same places. So, for example, I'll be able to fit it into this tower without any modifications. But other than that, there's not much left the same. So let's do this step by step. At the heart of this computer is a next generation Broadcom chip designated BCM2712. It's a 2.4 GHz quad-core 64-bit ARM Cortex-A76 CPU created with a 16 nanometers process node. All of these cores are high performance, not power efficiency cores like some on chips of its competitors. What I have in mind is the excellent chip made by Rockchip, the RK3588, which states that it has 8 cores. Granted, it's true, but it could be better known that it only has 4 high performance A76 cores, like in the Raspberry Pi 5, and the rest are power efficient cores. This means they won't bring that much of a punch when it comes to performance. This Raspberry's Broadcom chip has 512 kilobytes per core L2 cache and 2 megabytes shared L3 cache. I can't say that this is the most powerful chip we've seen to this day, but at least in a way it closes the giant gap created between Raspberry Pi 4 and its competitors like Orange Pi or Rock Pi, Keras and other today's vendors. Next to this chip is also the GPU unit, VideoCore 7, so upgrade from VideoCore 6 of the Raspberry Pi 4, which runs on 800 MHz instead of 500 MHz, which is quite a substantial leap, I must say. It supports OpenGL for embedded systems and, to my great pleasure, the Vulkan 1.2. If you're not familiar with Vulkan, there's been a fuss around it in graphics circles in the last few years. You could say it's a next-generation OpenGL, but there's more to it, and that's not in the scope of this preview. Just wanted to let you know. This VideoCore 7 can handle dual 4K displays at 60 frames per second via these two micro HDMI ports or via these two 4-lane MIPI DSi/CSI connectors. It supports HDR, the high dynamic range, which means in very simpler terms, nicer colors and output. When it comes to RAM, the Raspberry Pi 5 will launch in two versions, the 4GB and 8GB versions. There's nothing special about this, it's just your preference. But what is special or new is the LPDDR4X. LPDDR4X, compared to LPDDR4 without the X, runs at 4266 MHz and uses less power than the memory in Pi 4, meaning it's much faster than its predecessor. By how much? It's 2 to 4 times faster with latencies cut to the half while using less power. That's a great achievement. But to be fair, it's still not as fast as the RK3588 due to the less efficient process node and lack of efficient cores. On the other hand, you need to pay for that. And I think Raspberry still aims to be affordable and the end product price is of concern to them. I'm getting ahead of myself, but you'll be able to get the 8GB version for $80 and the 4GB version for $60. Keep that in mind while I'm talking about this stuff. So these are the core parts, and when we sum it up, we can say that the Raspberry Pi 5 will be 2 to 3 times faster than the Raspberry Pi 4. It might not be as fast as other high-end SBCs on the market, but the combo of price to performance to software support will be stunning. Not to mention that all the faster SBCs will cost, and do cost, significantly more than Raspberry Pi 5. Okay, we covered the three essential parts of every computer, the CPU, GPU and RAM. Let's continue. What else is new on the Raspberry Pi 5? Networking. One could say it's almost identical to the Raspberry Pi 4. The Ethernet is still 1 gigabit. Duh, insert set trombone sound. But the Wi-Fi speed is nearly double. Wake on LAN should be possible in the future, but it's not right now. But it's all about software, so maybe they'll figure it out by the time it's released. Fingers crossed. What's worth mentioning is this Southbridge chip designed by Raspberry Pi themselves, named RP1. It facilitates the communication between the SoC, the Broadcom main chip, and the rest of the board. It has controllers for these two USB 3 and USB 2 ports, and controls the Ethernet port and the GPIO pins, the general input-output pins. The RP1 adds features to the Ethernet port like PTP support, PTP stands for Precision Time Protocol, and more. The combined USB throughput is more than doubled thanks to this chip, so transferring data between two USB attached devices will be lightning fast. The RP1 is pretty smart guy. Across the board, on the other side, right next to the power button, yep, we finally have a power button on Raspberry Pi, is this PMIC, the Power Management Integrated Circuit. What is it good for? It finally solves the RTC or real-time clock issue on Raspberry. It can track time like your usual PC. To shed some light on it for you, before Raspberry Pi 5, when you powered off the, let's say, Raspberry Pi 4, the device wrote down the current time and stopped keeping track of it. The next time you booted it up, it just continued to count time from the last known time, which could be way off. Of course, it would correct the mistake when your Raspberry was connected to the internet or to some device that provided it with a new accurate time. However, this was a problem for Raspberry is not connected to the internet, as it could have thrown off most basic things and in some rare cases lock you out if you used features like 2FA authentication. So this dialog chip solves it. Of course, you'll need a RTC battery, but that's not a problem. Again, good boy. And it also facilitates the power management for the new, more power-hungry peripherals and faster chip. Pi 5, with all its new peripherals, can consume up to 25 watts of energy. That's why a new power brick is needed. In theory, you can run it with your old power supply in low power mode, but to be on the safe side and avoid any problems, I'd recommend buying the new 5-amp power supply. So, let's have a look at the whole Raspberry Pi 5. We've covered the main chip, the Southbridge, the PMIC dialog chip, USB ports, Ethernet, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. So, what else is new? Look, just not to forget it, we lost the audio jack over here, but I'll be bold on this one and say that it is not that much of a loss. If you used it, let me know your use case. I'm really interested. Continue. Right here is the modal indicator. It's a simple resistor right next to a modal version. It doesn't even work or do anything, but according to this, we can anticipate that versions with 1 GB and 2 GB of RAM will be released at some point in the future. Remember, the only officially announced versions for now are 4 and 8 GB versions. Over here is the long missing sun, the power button. Here is the RTC battery connector, a UART connector and a fan connector. These two are the micro HDMI connectors and these two are dual purpose 4-lane MIPI DSI/CSI connectors. Through them we can connect two cameras or two displays to Raspberry Pi. I would say it was worth losing the audio jack in this position. These two are mounting holes for the heatsink, preferably with an active fan. This new chip can get quite hot under the load. PoE head connector, which isn't available right now, but should be soon. And the best at the end. Over here is the PCI Express interface. Right now, there are no heads or extensions we can buy and plug into it, but it opens a wide range of possibilities for the Raspberry Pi 5 and for us in the future. Can't wait to see them. And I think that's it. On the back side, there's nothing special, just the SD card slot, but it needs to be said that it should support the high-speed SDR 104 mode, meaning that the read-write speeds should be double that of its predecessor. But it's still an SD card, so nothing reliable. I would advise you to pick something more reliable for your project. The heads for M2 drives should be available by the end of the year. One more thing that's worth mentioning. The new Raspberries are produced in Sony factories in the UK and the Raspberry Pi 5 should remain in production until at least January of 2035. So if you plan to use it for your long-term project or in some enterprise-grade project, you should be safe for at least 10 to 15 years. And that can't be said with certainty for all of its competitors. Thanks for watching. It would be nice of you if you hit that subscribe button. See you next time. Bye.